Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My name is Mohamed Taman. Today I will talk about placental functions and umbilical cord and fetal circulation. At the beginning, we should know that the placenta is the main main unit that is responsible for transfusion of nutrients and excretion of waste products between the maternal and fetal circulation. The cyto and sensitive trophoblast are the main cells that is concerned with formation of the future placenta. This is where the future placenta will be formed. That's why any abnormality of the placenta may lead to a major obstetric problem, and this barrier of transfusion has the main function in this function. We should also know that there is another term which is called fetal membranes. We have two fetal membranes. We have the chorion and the amnion. The chorion is mostly formed and lying toward the uterine cavity, and the amnion is toward the amniotic sac and toward the fetus. This is the chorion and this is the amnion. The placenta itself has two surfaces. It has a fetal surface which is toward the fetal part, and through this surface there is an attachment of the umbilical cord, and this surface is smooth and glistening. And there is another surface which is called the maternal part. This maternal part contains many cotyledons, between 15 to 20 cotyledons, and this is a rough surface, and it is attached mainly toward the maternal side. This placenta, a term, is weighing about 0.5 kilogram, and its diameter is about 15 up to 20 centimeters. Its thickness in the center is about 2 inches, and it has a thin diameter at the periphery, and its color mostly it is dark red in color. This is again the fetal surface, and this is the maternal surface, and this is the attachment of the umbilical cord. In this diagram, we should know also that this is the site of the formation of the placenta. This site mostly will be in the upper uterine segment. In about 60% of cases, it will be in the posterior part, and about 40% of cases, it will be in the anterior uterine wall. This is the fetal surface of the placenta. This fetal surface is smooth and glistening, and this is the maternal surface, and this is rough and contains many cotyledons, and this is the attachment of the umbilical cord through which the umbilical artery and the umbilical vein are going to bring the blood supply to the fetus. These are the main functions of the placenta. The placenta has a protective function, a nutritive function, a respiratory function, excretory function, and it has hormone secreting function. These are the functions of the placenta. We have a mechanical function. Through this function, the placenta is going to fix the fetus toward the uterine wall, and there is a nutritive function. There is a passive and active transfer of many nutrients and many electrolytes through the placental barrier. And this placenta also have respiratory functions. This respiratory function is responsible for transfer of oxygen by simple diffusion and CO2. This oxygen is going to be transferred between the maternal and fetal surfaces. And there is also excretory function of the waste products like urea and uric acid. We have also immunological function. It secretes many antibodies like IgG antibodies and IgM antibodies. This IgG antibody have low molecular weight. That's why it could be easily passed through the placenta. However, this IgM antibody is high molecular weight, and it's difficult to be passed through the placenta. As regard the endocrinal function of the placenta, it secretes many hormones. Like, the most famous one is the human chorionic gonadotropin, the human placental lactogen, relaxin hormone, placental inhibin, and the placental activin. It also secretes many proteins. Like, this famous one is the pregnancy associated plasma protein A, and it is associated with many of the congenital anomalies and trisomies that happens in most of patients at high risk to develop congenital anomalies. Also, it secretes many enzymes like oxytocinase, histaminase, and monoamine oxidase, and these are the most famous enzymes that are secreted by the placenta: oxytocinase and histaminase enzymes. This oxytocinase plays an important role in prevention of occurrence of labor pain till the term pregnancy is going to be between 37 and 40 weeks of gestation. At this point, we are going to talk about the placental barrier, which is the main area where the placenta is going to pass the nutrient material and to excrete the waste product. This is the placental barrier, and if we're going to magnify this area, we will find that this area containing a maternal blood vessels, and this is the fetal blood vessel, and this is the barrier itself. This is the fetal blood, and this is the maternal, this is the fetal blood, and this is the maternal blood. And this is the barrier between the placenta and between the fetus and the mother. If we are going to examine this area under microscopy, we will find that the fetal endothelial cells, there is a fetal connective tissue, there is a chronic epithelial cells, there is endometrial epithelial tissue, there is a maternal connective tissue, and this is a maternal endothelial cells. These are the cells and the component of the placental barrier that is present between the maternal and fetal circulation. This diagram shows here is the side of the maternal blood, and here is the epithelial lining of the maternal circulation, and there is the fetal blood, and there is a connective tissue in between, and there is a cyto and sensitio trophoblast. This is the layers of the future placenta that will bypass the nutrient and waste products between this barrier between the maternal and fetal sites. For the placenta to be formed, there should be a waves of invasion. These waves of invasion happens in two stages. The first stage happens in the first trimester, and the second stage happens after 20 weeks of gestation. Through these waves of invasion, the main role of this invasion is to transfer these blood vessels, which is in the non-gravid area, which is small sized and in arteriolar structure, into a wider blood vessel, and it should be changed between arteriolar component into a sinusoidal like component. This arteriolar component contains many muscles in the media of the blood vessel. This muscle should not be present in the sinusoidal pattern that is formed after 20 weeks of gestation. If there is failure of this remodeling of this arteriolar pattern into this venous pattern, many abnormalities will happen, like preeclampsia, where the main problem in preeclampsia is the failure of remodeling of this arteriolar pattern into a sinusoidal pattern. And most of these patients will have vasospasm and decrease of the blood supply that is going to supply the fetus. That's why most of these patients will have IOGR or intrauterine growth restrictions. This is the normal pregnancy, and this is what happens in severe preeclampsia. Again, these are the waves of invasion. It happens in two stages. The first stage occurs at time of implantation in the first trimester, and the second stage occurs after 20 weeks of gestation. Through these waves of invasion, there should be a change in the arteriolar pattern into sinusoidal pattern, and there should be increase in the diameter of the blood vessels from this smaller arteriolar size into this large sinusoidal size to bring more blood supply to the baby. And if there is a failure in this process, that occurs mostly after 20 weeks of gestation, a major problem like preeclampsia, severe preeclampsia, will happen. And most of patients having severe preeclampsia will have this problem after 20 weeks of gestation. This is the age of the second wave of invasion. Here is the arteriolar pattern that should be changed into sinusoidal pattern after 20 weeks of gestation. Again, this is non-gravid uterus. Here is the shape of the arteriolar structure of the spiral artery, which is a branch of the uterine artery. This spiral artery should be changed into this wide structure, which is the sinusoidal pattern, which happens due to invasion of the placenta through this area. And this happens in two waves, as we said before. The first wave occurs in the first trimester, and the second wave occurs at 20 weeks of gestation. And if there is failure of this formation, there will be a major problem, which is concerned with the growth restriction of the fetus and severe preeclampsia of the mother. If you notice here, there is a large difference between the diameter of this blood vessel and the diameter of these blood vessels. This happens in preeclampsia, and this happens in normal pregnancy. If you are going to see how the blood nutrients and most of the nutrients and waste product will be transferred through the placental barrier, oxygen and CO2 is going to go by simple diffusion. This simple diffusion is going to be according to the concentration gradient. I mean, if there is a high oxygen level in the maternal side, it will pass easily by simple diffusion from the high concentration to the low concentration, from the maternal side to the fetal side. And the opposite is present with the high CO2 levels, where there is high CO2 in the fetal side and there is low CO2 in the maternal side. That's why this will allow the transfusion between the fetal to the maternal side. This is an example of the simple diffusion of this oxygen and CO2. Again, oxygen and CO2 are going to bypass through the placental barrier according to the concentration gradient, or as we said, by simple diffusion. Here is the concentration gradient between the oxygen and CO2 between the mother and the maternal and fetal circulation, and again this is happens by simple diffusion. This is another function of the placenta, which have the ability to secrete some proteins like pregnancy associated plasma protein A, some hormones like human chorionic gonadotropins, some hormones like placental estrogen and alpha fetoproteins. Most of these markers have a higher relation with occurrence of congenital anomalies, especially trisomies, especially Down syndrome. This is human chorionic gonadotropin, which is the main hormone of the placental function. This is pregnancy associated plasma protein A, and this is estriol with E3, which is specific for the placental functions. If you notice here, this is the levels of human chorionic gonadotropin that is going to be secreted by the placenta, and we should know that this hormone, which is HCG, have this curve having to be a peak level after about 100 days, or at about 9 to 10 weeks of gestation. At this area, this is the peak of this hormonal secretion, and this after that is going to be decreased after that till the end of the first trimester. And if you notice here, it is associated mainly with the occurrence of nausea and vomiting. That is going to be, it has many theories, and one of the most famous theories that it is related to the secretion of beta HCG. That's why most of patients will have these problems in the first trimester, and at the end of the first trimester, with the decrease of the level of the beta HCG, most of these patients will have resolution of these symptoms, and there will no complaint of nausea and vomiting in most of patients, and about 90% of patients after the first trimester. This is the hormonal level of HCG, and again it's going to be decreased in level after the end of the first trimester, after 12 weeks of gestation. This is another example of one of the famous proteins that is secreted by the placenta, which is a pregnancy associated plasma protein A, which has a very high association with trisomies, especially Down syndrome, trisomy 13 and trisomy 18. In this slide, you should know that to calculate the risk of congenital anomalies, we have to estimate some of the risk factors that is associated with occurrence of these congenital anomalies. Here is an example of the screening that could happen in the first trimester using the plasma pregnancy associated plasma protein A, human chorionic gonadotropin, and the maternal age. And if you notice here, we have about 60% of patients have risk of having these trisomies if you found that there is abnormality in these levels in the first trimester. If you are going to screen the second trimester, we have what we call triple test. This triple test is composed of alpha fetoprotein, beta HCG, estradiol in association with the maternal age. If you notice here, there is about 70% of occurrence of congenital anomaly if there is abnormality in this triple test. At sometimes we can request the quadruple test, and we should have to add inhibin A. This inhibin A, if it is added to this triple test, it will increase its sensitivity up to 80% of detection of congenital anomalies of high risk patients. And at this point, if you have this high percentage of occurrence of this congenital anomaly, you may be in need to do invasive techniques like chorionic villus sampling or amniocentesis. Again, the placenta itself do its functions by simple diffusion for gases, waters, and electrolyte. There may be also a facilitated diffusion. This facilitated diffusion needs a carrier. These carriers can carry large molecular weight molecules like glucose, amino acids, and the minerals. And we have also something like pinocytosis. There is engulf of the large particles to be invaginated inside the toward the fetal site to take these large particles toward the fetal site. If you notice here, this is the maternal side and this is the fetal side, and these are the products that is needed to be go to the fetus, and these are the waste products that will go to the mother. And again, most of these waste product will go by simple diffusion. If you notice here, these are example of the glucose, amino acids, and the fatty acids. Most of these large molecular weight products will be in need of these carriers. These carriers will take these products from the maternal side to the fetal side. This is the large molecular weight glucose, amino acids, and fatty acids, and this go to be through carriers. This is an example of the pinocytosis, where the large particles is going to be engulfed by these structures to be invaginated inside the fetal side, when this happens mainly for large molecular structures. And these are examples of the invasive techniques that is needed for detection of congenital anomalies. This is a trans-cervical or transvaginal aspiration of the amniotic fluid or chorionic villus sampling, and this is a trans-abdominal aspiration. This should be done under ultrasound guidance. We have to take a specimen or a sample from the chorionic villus or from the amniotic fluid. Also, we have a tool that can detect the amount of the blood supply that is going to reach the fetus through this umbilical cord, and this could be done by evaluation of the fetal blood supply through the fetal Doppler. This Doppler is going to estimate the amount of the blood that is going to supply the fetus through this umbilical cord. Again, this is very important in detecting patients having intratriangular restriction, and if there is a problem in the process of invasion after 20 weeks of gestation, and most of these patients will have these problems if they have preeclampsia. As we said before, these are the main functions of the placenta, as we said, and now we will talk about the abnormalities that could be present in the placenta. We have abnormalities in the shape of the placenta. The placenta may be consisted of two loops. We call it bilobed placenta. It may be multiple loops, so it's called multi-lobed placenta or multipartite placenta. We can have accessory loop, which is called succinteriate placenta. It could be shaped ring-shaped placenta or membranous-shaped placenta, fenestrated placenta or extrachoroidal placenta, circumvallate or circummarginate, as we will see. This is an example of the bipartite or bilobed placenta. There are two loops of the placental tissue. Here is one lobe and here is the other lobe, and there is a membrane connecting between both of these loops. And this is an example of accessory lobe of the placenta. This is called the placenta succinteriata or succinteriate placenta. There is an accessory lobe attached to the placenta. Here we have two equal loops, but here we have two unequal loops. For the placental size, we have a large placenta if it's weight. Now we said that the placental weight is mostly 500 grams. If it is more than 600 grams, it's called large placenta, and it happens in patients having diabetes mellitus, anemia, congenital nephritis, syphilis, RH incompatibility, or fetal lung malformation. We may also have some placental polyps or adhesions of the placenta, which is a main problem that is attached firmly to the uterine wall. It will form a placenta accreta, increta, or percreta. Here is the site of normal implantation, and there is abnormal site of implantation in the lower uterine segment, and it could be attached firmly to the uterine wall by dense adhesions that at this point we call it placenta accreta, increta, or percreta. The placenta also may be affected in many diseases. We may have placental infarction. There may be an area in the placenta where there is a red infarction, or there is a white infarction, where there is thrombosis or decrease of the blood supply to a certain area of the placenta. That's why an ischemia and infarction will happen at this area. It may be red in color, or there may be deposition of fibrin that will lead to its formation in whitish in color. Or it may be affected by some diseases like syphilis. Placenta will be heavy, pale and yellow, boggy and friable. TB also may affect the placenta in many patients, and this will be formed of tubercle inside the placenta with caseating material that will be formed inside the placenta. In patients having RH incompatibility or erythroblastosis fetalis, there will be a large size of the placenta, and there will be edema of the placenta like the fetal hydrops that is present in most of the parts of the fetus. There will be a large placenta with fetal hydrops also. There may be also formation of hemangioma, and at this point you call it chorioangioma. There is a hamartomatous malformation or vascular malformation in the placental blood vessels, which is called chorioangioma of the placenta, and affect only 1% of patients. Again, these are some examples of the placenta. Here is an example of the succinteriate placenta. There is an accessory lobe of the placenta. Here we have two equal lobes of the placenta, which is called bilobed placenta. We have circumvallate placenta. Here there is an exaggeration or formation of crescentic part of the placental tissue around the attachment of the umbilical cord. It's called circumvallate placenta. If this hypertrophied area is going to be formed in the periphery of the placenta. It's called circummarginate placenta. Again, circumvallate is hypertrophied area around the attachment of the umbilical cord. Circumvallate is attachment of the hypertrophied area in the periphery of the placenta. Here is an example of the attachment of the umbilical cord. The attachment could be marginal insertion. The mostly of the umbilical cords will be attached in the eccentric area of the placenta. It could be attached to the periphery of the placenta, or it have filamentous insertion. In this filamentous insertion, the umbilical cord is going to be inserted into a membrane, and this membrane will be inserted into the placenta, and at this point you call it filamentous insertion of the umbilical cord. Again, this is an example of accessory placenta or succinteriate placenta. This is a circumvallate placenta. There is a concentric area around the attachment of the umbilical cord, and this is a circummarginate, and this is marginal insertion of the cord, and this is filamentous insertion of the umbilical cord. Here the umbilical cord is attached to a membrane, and this membrane is going to be attached to the placenta. Again, these are example. This is a circumvallate placenta, this is a succinteriate placenta, this is a bilobed placenta, this is a filamentous insertion of the cord is attached to a membrane, and this membrane is going to be attached to the placenta itself, and this is a marginal insertion of the umbilical cord. This is an example of the bipartite placenta or bilobed placenta. There are two equal lobes of the placenta, and here is what we call placenta membranacea. There is a thinning of the placenta itself, and it will be forming something like a membrane. This membrane is very thin and is called a membrane-like structure. That's why we call it placenta membranacea. And here we have an example of the circummarginate placenta. Here is a concentric area around the periphery of the placenta, and here is a circumvallate placenta. This hypertrophied area is around the attachment of the umbilical cord. Here is an example of the placental hemangioma or chorioangioma. There is a hematomatous malformation or chorioangioma that is going to be formed in some of the blood vessels of the placenta, forming this hemangioma. And there is an example of the infarction that could happen of the placenta. If there is thrombosis of some of its blood vessels, there will be ischemia and gangrene of this part, and it could be reddish in color, and if there is fibrin deposition inside this area, there will be whitish discoloration. Here is another example of the abnormal implantation of the placenta. This is the normal site of placental implantation. It is implanted in the upper uterine segment, 60% in the posterior uterine wall, and 40% in the anterior wall. And this is the problem of the placenta previa, where the placenta is going to be implanted in the lower uterine segment. It could be a grade 1, type grade 2, or grade 3. We have three grades of placenta previa, where the placenta is going to be implanted in the lower uterine segment, not in the upper uterine segment, like what should happen in normal pregnancy. There is another example of the placental separation. The placenta could be normally implanted in its site, where there is a separation of the placenta from its attachment to the uterine wall with formation of the retroplacental hematoma. And this happens mainly in patients having severe preeclampsia, and this is called accidental hemorrhage. If you notice here, this is the shape of the placenta by ultrasound. It's a grayish, homogeneous-like structure. Below this area is heterogeneous mass. This heterogeneous mass mostly is the retroplacental hematoma that is going to separate the placenta from its attachment to the uterine wall. And again, this may be a major problem to the fetus, as it may prevent its blood supply, and fetal distress will happen after this. If you look for this photo, this is how the uterus looks from outside. If you are going to do laparotomy for this patient or do an urgent cesarean section, this blood or this hematoma will going to decussate between the muscles of the uterus and will give you this bluish discoloration of the uterine wall. And this bluish discoloration mostly will be characteristic of what we call cavalier uterus, which happens in most patients having accidental hemorrhage or having severe preeclampsia. This is retroplacental hematoma, and this is how hematoma looks by ultrasound. This is also the retroplacental hematoma, and this is the cavalier uterus, as we said. Now, at this point, we have finished the anomalies that could happen in the placenta. We will talk now about the abnormalities that could happen in the umbilical cord. But at the start, you should know what is the normal parts of the umbilical cord. The umbilical cord should be about 50 centimeter in diameter, in its length. In length, it contains two arteries and one veins, and it contains Wharton's jelly. And it's covered by amnion, and it's inserted in eccentric area or near to the center of the placenta in about 70% of cases. Again, this is two arteriolar structure, and this is one vein, two arteries and one vein, and this is Wharton's jelly in between, and there is about 40 to 70 centimeter in length, and it's attached about 70% of patients to the eccentric part of the placenta. The anomalies that could happen in the cord, we may have a long cord. This long cord could be if the length of the cord itself is more than 80 centimeters, or could be short if it is less than 35 centimeters. And this short cord and this long cord carry also many complications that could happen. Here we can have a coils of the cord that could be around the neck of the fetus or formation of a knot. The short cord also can lead to placental abruption or placental separation with the movement of the baby. There may be also absence of one of the umbilical arteries, and this is one of the fetal congenital anomaly signs that could be detected by ultrasound. Here we have abnormalities in the insertion of the cord. We have what we call marginal insertion. It is inserted in the periphery or in the margin of the placenta. We call it battledore insertion or velamentous insertion. And again, in this velamentous insertion, the cord is going to be inserted into a membrane, and this membrane is going to be inserted into the periphery of the placenta. Here is a marginal insertion of the cord, and this is the velamentous insertion. Here the umbilical cord is going to be inserted into a membrane, and this membrane is going to be inserted into the placenta. This is an example. This is a central insertion of the umbilical cord, and this is eccentric insertion, and it happens in 70% of normal pregnancies. This is markedly eccentric insertion, and this is marginal insertion. It is attached to the periphery of the placenta, and this is velamentous insertion where the cord is attached to a membrane, and this membrane is going to be attached to the placenta. Also, there is another problem that could happen in the attachment of the cord, which is called a vasa brevia. In this vasa brevia, the blood vessel here is coming from the fetus. If you look for this picture, this is the placenta, and this is the umbilical cord, and this is a blood vessel coming to cross over the internal os of the cervix, and the origin of this blood is coming from the fetus. That's why if there is a tear in this area, there will be loss of blood which is coming from the fetus, not from the maternal side, because this connection is coming from the fetal blood vessel toward the maternal blood vessels. Again, this is a very critical area, and if it is diagnosed by ultrasound, you should not allow this patient to deliver vaginally, because with the occurrence of labor pain and dilatation of the cervix and the descent of the fetal head, there may be a tear in this area, and with the occurrence of this tear, there will be severe bleeding, and this blood is coming from the fetus, not from the mother, and it will have I carry a very high risk of fetal death, as we said, and the fetal mortality in these conditions may reach up to 70% of cases. If you look here, this is a Doppler. This is Doppler is detecting the blood that is going to cross over the internal os. This is the same like this. Again, this is called vasa brevia. For this vasa brevia, if you notice here, there is a blood vessels that is going to be communicated between the placenta and the umbilical cord, and again this blood vessels is coming from the fetal side, not from the maternal side. That's why any injury in these vessels will lead to severe fetal bleeding. And this slide is summarizing what we have said and how to diagnose and how to deal with these patients. Again, we have here another example of the anomalies that could happen in the umbilical cord. We have here a true knot of the umbilical cord. If it is long, there may be a true knot of the umbilical cord. And this knot, if it is tightened with the fetal movement, it may lead to intrauterine fetal death in about 2% of cases. This is a true knot of the umbilical cord. Or you may have just thickening of the Wharton's jelly leading to formation of what we call false knot of the umbilical cord. It is a false knot. It is not like a true knot of the umbilical cord. You may also have some loops of the umbilical cord that's going to encircle the head of the baby, or there may be a torsion of the umbilical cord that may lead to ischemia. This is example of the coils, and this is ischemia of the umbilical cord if it is going to be torted upon itself. The cord itself is going to be torted. There may be an ischemia of the umbilical cord itself. Also, you may have a stricture in the umbilical cord or hematoma of the blood vessels of the cord. There is a stricture here of the umbilical cord. This is an area where there is a spasm or a stricture in the umbilical cord, or there may be a hematoma in the cord. You may find also a cyst in the umbilical cord. It could be a true cyst or false cyst. This true cyst could be small, or could be false cyst, just a liquefaction of the Wharton's jelly. Or you may find edema inside the umbilical cord where there is Rh incompatibility and macro and macerated babies. Now we will talk about how the blood is going to pass through the baby or the fetal circulation after its arrival from the maternal side, and we will discuss now the point of the fetal circulation. You should know that we have the umbilical cord is the main area of this communication, and this umbilical cord again contains two arteries and one vein. And this is the placental side after the blood is going to come from the placenta to pass to the fetus, and we'll see how it is going to pass through the heart as we will see in the following pictures. Yes, if we start from here, this is the placenta where the blood is going to pass to the fetus. After the blood is going from the placenta, it will go through the umbilical vein to the fetus, and again this blood contains oxygenated blood. This blood is going to pass through the ductus venosus to the inferior vena cava, and this is the major part of the blood, and the small amount of blood will go to the liver, and after it's going to the liver, it will supply the liver, and it will go through the hepatic veins again to the inferior vena cava. After its collection in the inferior vena cava, it will go to the right atrium, and inside the right atrium, the main part of the blood is going to pass through the foramen ovale, to pass to the left atrium, then to the left ventricle, then to the aorta. After it's going to pass to the aorta, the blood is going to pass through the systemic circulation to the umbilical artery to the placenta again. If we go back to this area, the blood in the right atrium have another part that's going to bypass to pass to the right ventricle. After its passage to the right ventricle, it will go to the pulmonary trunk to pass to the lung to supply the lung, and it will come again to the left atrium through the pulmonary veins. And after the left atrium, it will pass to the left ventricle to the aorta. Part of the blood that is going to pass from the pulmonary trunk will go to the ductus arteriosus to the aorta again, and all the blood will be collected again with systemic supply, and this blood is mixed between the arterial and venous blood, and this goes to the umbilical arteries to the placenta again. If you notice here, this is the placenta. The blood is going here through the umbilical vein. Most of the blood will go through the ductus venosus to the inferior vena cava, and part of the blood will go to the liver. And after this, it will go through the hepatic veins to the inferior vena cava again. After that, it will go to the right atrium. Through the right atrium, it will pass to the left atrium through the foramen ovale. Part of the blood will go to the right ventricle, to the pulmonary artery, from the pulmonary artery to the ductus arteriosus to the aorta. The part of the blood that's going to pass through the left atrium will go to the left ventricle, will go to the aorta to supply the systemic circulation, and after that it will go through the umbilical arteries again to the placenta to do its excretory function through the umbilical arteries. Again, if you look here, this is the blood that is going through the umbilical vein. This blood is going to supply the liver, and part of the blood will go to the inferior vena cava through the ductus arteriosus, through the ductus venosus, and the part that is going to supply the liver will go back to the inferior vena cava through the hepatic veins. It will go to the right atrium, to the foramen ovale, to the left ventricle, to the left atrium, to the left ventricle, to the aorta. And part of the blood will go to the right ventricle, to the pulmonary artery, to the ductus arteriosus, to the aorta again. Then it will go to the aorta. After it's supplied to the systemic circulation, it will go through the umbilical arteries to go again to the placenta. After delivery, with cutting of this umbilical cord, there will be formation of what you call ligamentum teres. This is the fate of the umbilical vein. It will be ligamentum teres. Again, the ductus venosus here will be transformed into ligamentum venosum inside the liver, and the ductus arteriosus will be transformed into ligamentum arteriosus here, and these umbilical arteries will be transformed into lateral umbilical arteries. This is the umbilical vein. It will be transformed into ligamentum teres. This is the ductus venosus. It will be transformed into ligamentum venosum. This is the umbilical arteries. It will be transformed into lateral umbilical ligaments. This is the foramen ovale. It will be transformed into fossa ovale. And this is the ligamentum arteriosus. deductus arteriosus, it will be transformed into ligamentum arteriosus. Again, the foramen ovale will be transformed into fossa ovale. Umbilical vein will be transformed into ligamentum teres. Ductus venosus will be transformed into ligamentum venosum. Umbilical arteries will be transformed into umbilical ligaments, either lateral or medial umbilical ligaments. Ductus arteriosus will be transformed into ligamentum arteriosus. And this is a summary of what we have said again, and the fate of each of the blood vessels. This is the umbilical vein. Here is the blood is going to pass to the liver, and part will pass to the inferovena cava. And this is the hepatic veins will pass to the inferovena cava again. This is to the right atrium, to the left atrium through the foramen ovale, to the left ventricle, to the aorta. Part of the blood here will go to the right ventricle, to the pulmonary artery, to the ductus arteriosus, to the aorta, and it will form it will pass again to the umbilical arteries, to the placenta again. And by the end of this lecture, I hope that all of you is going the benefit of this lecture, and thank you very much.